So the K was to know what you want, get some help in getting that from some benchmarks. The F is once you have your internet, start doing analytics. If you don't know how to do analytics, you can get students to show you, Google Analytics, just start tracking and have someone tell you what it means. What we find with business owners, they find this a little bit daunting. And there is a rule, it's called the Rule of 12, or one business cycle. 12 months, one business cycle. It takes you about a year to get the hang of this, but you have to make that investment. It's like learning how to drive, it's like learning how to date, it's like learning how to take care of your first child. It takes about a year to get the hang of it. C, the K, is knowing. The F is finding. The C is change what you're doing until you get what you want. And I've been working with some students who have just started this website called G-Shift Labs. It turns out G-Shift Labs is probably the number one business now in Canada for search engine optimization. It probably costs you about $400 a month to have them optimize your website. In other words, if Kilborn's had hired this group of young people to manage their search engine optimization, if I typed in Kilborn's or Shoes in Westport, they would show up on the first page. But most people can't do this themselves. They don't know how to optimize their website. So in other words, it's one thing to have access to the internet, something else to say I want my business on the website, but something entirely different to have someone find you on the website. And it'll cost you between $400 and $600 a month for that to happen. So the takeaway is, having a virtual presence, in my opinion, is probably more important than actually having a store. As your store closes, this doesn't. This doesn't. And if you're really serious about it, no matter where you live, about going online, you have to be patient. Take baby steps. This will take you some time to get really good at it. So it takes the patience and some money. It's an investment. It does require financial commitment. But it's an investment in your business. Probably the best advice I can give you is you can use, we have a service here called Queen's Business Consulting. It's $10 an hour. You get excellent help with our top students. Or you can call people like you see in this room and they can point you in the right direction. 5 minutes.
Thank you. All right. Well, thank you, everyone. Well, it's your turn. I leave the slide up. But the bottom line is that you can address questions to any of our panelists. And we encourage you simply to raise your hand and start speaking. So thank you.
Just want to know for the broadband rollout, how do you see the take up happening in rural, very rural areas where they've only had dial-up forever? Do you have a master plan for that?
We'll start it today at the seminar.
Yeah.
our commitment to the government is to build the infrastructure and make sure that the access is available. There's a whole other layer that has to sit on top of that for communications and many of the other presentations. Getting out to the communities to talk about business strategy, to talk about utilization, to talk about how to use the infrastructure that we're building. We'll support our private sector partners in the whole of the communications around pricing. Our commitment is specifically to the infrastructure. So we're already talking to the Monieson Center and others about how do we measure and assess the impact of that infrastructure on economic development and how do we take that information and get it out there. There's some people that don't have any internet access or maybe have like dial-up or something. 10 meg, they're not going to want 10 meg. They'll be happy with 1.5 or 5 or 3 or 5. So we definitely need to develop partnerships to get a communication strategy together.
If I can comment, David, we potentially would have another whole group of stakeholders who would be involved in that particular process, being the internet service providers that are already out there. I think there's about 50 or 60 of them across Eastern Ontario. So I'm thinking it might be them as much as you.
Yeah.
Or you want that would actually take the lead on that. But up to this point in time, they haven't had the backbone to work with. If that's in place, then I would think they would be much more interested in trying to market that service to people in their
certainly private sector partners will have a great role in communicating that message.
All right, it's one thing to roll out internet broadband. It's another thing to maintain it, and it's another thing to upgrade it. So are there plans for the maintenance and the upgrade?
Yes, so these are all competitively tendered contracts, both on the backbone satellite and on the access. We're just going to tender now. And a huge component of it took us over 8 months to negotiate the contracts with the government on the one side and almost longer on the private sector on the other. And one of those things is trying to figure out the long-term sustainability. So the government funding ends in 4 years and the infrastructure has to be built within those 4 years. But our contracts have, the first stage of the contract is really 7 years, and then 7 years beyond that. There's a 14-year commitment on pricing, open access, risk mitigation, upgrade. On the backbone, for example, we tendered for a 1 gig scalable to 10 gig backbone based on all the assessment that Kathy and our engineers have done over the last 4 or 5 years. And the vendor that we chose is coming out with 10 gig out of the gate at 160 pops around Eastern Ontario, scalable to 100. And within that scalability, we have contractual obligations that as performance and capacity demands increase, they have to scale it up, otherwise there are penalties.
I can add on or follow up. I'm sure if we kind of look 5-10 years into the future, and you look at what's happening, let's say, just within the Kingston region, you know, you're going from maybe a megabit, if that's...
Sorry, maybe?
Maybe a megabit per second or something, and you're now demanding more and more and more. So as you start looking at the size of these pipes going from hot to various locations, projected what the demand will be in 10 years?
If I said we've done it scientifically, like I said, in the States they're looking at a gig to the home, right? So it's all guesswork and analysis. We've tried to factor in significant scalability, like 100 gig on the backbone, looking out 14 years by the end of that project, and considering the amount of fiber that's going in, technology that's going in, the life cycle of the electronics that's going in, all of those kind of things. I think we've done the best that we can talk to economists or engineers that try to predict the future of technology. There's a lot of guesswork in it, but I think we've certainly made an effort to